This is a download from the BBC. To find out more and our terms of use, go to bbcworldservice.com/podcasts.
This is Razia Iqbal with NewsHour, recorded on Tuesday, February the 3rd at 14 hours GMT. Coming up, rare testimony from those who survived a particularly brutal attack by Boko Haram in the northern Nigerian town of Baga.
When I was running, they were hunting us. Some people were falling and dying, others being run over with motorbikes.
You're listening to the BBC World Service coming to you live from London. Hello, I'm Razia Iqbal. This is NewsHour. Coming up in today's programme, let me take you back to exactly 1 month ago when reports began to emerge of a particularly horrific incident in the northern Nigerian town of Baga. Boko Haram had attacked the village and it was thought many had been killed. News of it, though, did not come to light immediately. Such is the fear and danger surrounding the situation where Boko Haram's writ prevails. In addition to that, journalists have been prevented from going anywhere near. The closest any have got was about 200 kilometres away. Amnesty International described what happened on January the 3rd as Boko Haram's deadliest massacre yet. Now, for the first time, our reporter, Tom Afesi, has been able to piece together what happened from speaking to survivors of the attack, people who only just managed to get away. We'll hear his report in just a moment. But first, I asked Toma how difficult this story was to cover.
If we take the example of Baga, for example, for days we had reports of the attack and we knew that many had been killed, but it was hard to make sense of what actually happened because there was no access to the area of the massacres. It was simply impossible to get to Baga or Doron Baga, the nearby town where a lot of people were killed on the shores of Lake Chad. Because Boko Haram is still there, the towns are still under the control of the insurgents. And so it's far too dangerous for us to travel there. Even for local journalists, it would be mad to try and reach these areas. In Nigeria itself, our colleagues, I think, have largely reported on the fact that you have so many conflicted reports, even within the government, about how many are killed or what operations are ongoing, that it is tremendously hard to report on whatever happens in the country. What we had to do for this investigation is to go on the other side of the lake where most of the refugees have fled, in Chad. And this is where we met some of the survivors and we were able to speak to them and try and make sense of what happened, try to paint a full picture of what happened in Baga that day on the 3rd of January.
The first raid came before dawn, around 5:30, just after the early prayers.
We are hearing gun from anywhere.
As Boko Haram fighters stormed through the west side of Baga, a group of determined young men tried to defend their town. Harun Mohammed, 31, was one of them.
We take our cutlass, we go and face them.
Cutlass, you mean your knives and machetes?
Knife, yes, something like that. We just defend ourselves. So after 6:30, we and the soldiers, we killed the Boko Haram. Boko Haram, they back to the bush.
It was a rare success. There was some relief, but it didn't last long.
After 2 hours, they came back again. They came many. We think that more than 1,000. So Boko Haram, they are just coming too much. So we and our soldiers and our police, so we started running.
It was absolute panic. Women and children, young and old, fled their homes and businesses, many heading for the nearby fishing town of Doron Baga on the shores of Lake Chad.
Boko Haram, they follow us to Dodoro. If gun didn't do anything to you, they will start killing people with their cars.
The shooting was indiscriminate. Hadija's husband was killed.
When I was running, they were hunting us. Some people were falling and dying, others being run over with motorbikes.
Many, including Saratu's father, are still missing.
The number of dead bodies, to be honest, was really unaccountable. There were so many. Women, men and children were all killed. The soldiers threw away their weapons. Some even threw them onto the water and on the ground. The vigilante took the weapons and were firing back. But they found the situation overwhelming and also fled.
The streets of Doron Baga were littered with bodies. Those who managed to dodge the bullets were forced down to the shores of the lake. Hussein Mohammed says Boko Haram militants didn't stop firing.
We got into a boat. We were speeding to get away. The men from Boko Haram were shooting at us and following us.
Some hid on nearby islands and waited through the night, hoping to return home. But as this man tells me, there was no going back.
By Sunday morning, we thought those people had gone, but they hadn't. We heard them shooting again. It wasn't possible to go back to get our belongings. The fire was raging.
These men and women you've heard are among the 15,000 refugees in Lake Chad. They fled without anything, many separated from their families. It's impossible to know how many people were killed during the attack, but our investigation suggests that hundreds may have died. Amnesty International reported that up to 2,000 people were killed, but we have found no evidence backing such claims. The real figures will probably never be known.
Na farko ita wannan gari tana bangare na arewa maso gabashin Najeriya ne kusa da tafkin Chad.
In this video, apparently posted online by Boko Haram, a man called Abi Musab al-Bernawi and described as the official spokesperson for the Islamist sect, says that they attacked Baga because the town is important in terms of commercial and military value to the Nigerian government. That day, Boko Haram seized a regional military base and with it, much hardware and weaponry. The massacres of Baga and Doron Baga happened a month ago. Boko Haram haven't been dislodged. And since then, the insurgents have attacked more towns in northeastern Nigeria. More people have died. Even more have been forced to flee their homes.
That was a special report on what happened on the 3rd of January in Baga from our correspondent Toma Fessi. Well, in the past hour since we've been on air, we've heard that Chadian troops have entered northern Nigeria in what appears to be an offensive against Boko Haram. We can join Mike Omeri now, Nigeria's government spokesman. Welcome to the programme. What can you tell us about the Chad offensive on the ground? Can you confirm that it's taking place and how many troops are involved?
Yeah, I may not be able to confirm the total number of troops involved, but to understand the situation, let me put it in perspective. First, there existed a security architecture of the Chad Basin Commission country since 1998. And thereafter, because it was not working as it should, only Niger had contributed troops to Baga at the time. And actually, the intention of the Chad Basin countries was to fight cross-border crime until the emergence of terrorism in that region. Now, what is happening is that there is a review of the plan. Instead of having the countries operate jointly, since it was not performing, the agreements were not performing since 1998, except the involvement of Chad and Nigerian troops, which have always been in Baga, there are currently bi-national understanding agreements between Nigeria and Chad, between Nigeria and Cameroon, and between Nigeria and Niger, all separately operating around that corridor.
Okay, so that's the context that you're setting out. What is there an offensive underway which has been led by the Chadian troops?
What is happening right now is that the agreement allows both countries to go on offensive into the territories of each other separately. So what is happening in Chad or in that corridor at the moment is that the Chadian troops, acting under the protocol of the bi-national agreement, are operating within that region and are also, after launching an offensive after Boko Haram.
Okay. So in addition to Chadian boots on the ground, there have also been at least 2 weeks of airstrikes against the insurgents. How confident are you that you are on top of this situation?
Well, Nigerian Air Force and the Chadian Air Force and others who have interest within that area, I think military interest within that area, are working hard to ensure that the insurgents are pushed to a corner. And it's been successful so far because a lot of gains have been recorded, including the retaking of territories and pushback from the forces operating. So we are confident that this coordinated response will reach the desired result.
Well, it's certainly true that the Nigerian army has managed to prevent Boko Haram taking Maiduguri, but it's not been possible for the Nigerian security forces to prevent the random suicide attacks that are still taking place along the election campaign. In fact, President Goodluck Jonathan just missed one by a small margin.
Suicide bombers come dressed like normal human beings and participate in all your activities and can take advantage of proximity to do what they have to do. It could be difficult for security forces to detect that. But even at that, I am aware that security forces and intelligence personnel have detected quite a number of such intending acts and have arrested the person involved. So it's an ongoing, comprehensive, tactical approach to finding a solution to not just the armed insurgents, but even those who perpetrate, who stab themselves with bombs.
Okay. We've been running a report today on our programme about what happened on January the 3rd in Baga. As the government spokesman, can you give us a definitive number on how many people were killed on that day by Boko Haram?
It was difficult, as at that time and today, to state the total number because a number of people have fled the area in the course of the fighting. So you cannot begin to assume people are dead, maybe meanwhile they are alive in other parts of the country. So the census and other surveys are ongoing at the moment to ascertain really those who are involved.
Okay.
Are dead or living with neighbours or in other parts of the country.
Mike Omeri, Nigeria's government spokesman, thanks very much for joining us. Not a great line, but I think we could make out what you were saying. Thank you for your time. You're listening to the BBC World Service. This is NewsHour.